Hey everybody, this is Pastor Mark from Abundant Living Family Church, High Desert, and we want to do our weekly webisode. We started a powerful, powerful series yesterday called The Power of Contentment. A lot of Christians today are not content. So we learned that contentment is actually a power that you can use in your life. The Word of God has some powerful things to say about humans being content. We learned that not having a biblical perspective, watch this, on being content can cause depression, insecurity, adultery, we talked a lot about that yesterday, greed, bad stewardship, that means you don't handle the things that you have correctly, unfulfilled desires, and an overall non-appreciation for things that we've already acquired. So I want you to get ready as we learn together how to be content. Here's a quote to get us started from some old dead guy. It says, do not spoil what you have by desiring what you have not. Ooh, that's powerful. Don't spoil what you already have by desiring what you have not. Watch this. Remember that what you have now was once among the things that you hoped for. Man, that's deep when it comes to contentment. Think about it. The clothes you have on right now, the car you're driving, the shoes you're wearing, at some point you didn't have those things. And here's the problem we have in America now, especially with Christians. We don't seem to have enough when in third world countries they don't have anything. People come up and say, Pastor Mark, I need prayer. I don't have this. I need this. I need that. But you got up in the morning, flipped through a whole closet full of clothes, looked through 100 pairs of shoes, put on all this jewelry to fix this all up. And why? Because you have too much. So we're going to learn today to be content. If you're not content, you will focus on the things that you don't have and miss what you do have. Everything you and I possess right now, we hoped for at one point in time. Woo! That's powerful. Now, to talk about the power of contentment, we need to look at what contentment means. Not from the dictionary standpoint, not from what you think, not from what I think, because we would say, contentment just means peace. No, we're going to look at the biblical word of contentment, and when you see what God framed this word around in the Greek, it is powerful. In the Greek, the word contentment is actually two words. It's a combination of words. And the Greek word is autocracy. Autocracy. It is two Greek words, auto and archacy. Auto and archacy. Now, the word auto in the Greek means self. So, two parts of the words. The first part means auto or self. And archacy actually means the idea, watch this, of raising a barrier or being enough or sufficient. So we have two definitions for contentment. Auto, meaning self, and the last word, archacy, meaning to raise a barrier or to be enough. Now watch what the biblical definition of contentment is. Personally, raising a barrier so something is enough. Woo-hoo! Wow, that's deep. Now watch this. God does not give you contentment. It's something that you have to learn. You learn how to be content. He doesn't just touch you. You can't go to a church service, have somebody lay hands on you, and you just get up and all of a sudden be content. It's something we have to learn. Now, where did we get that from? We studied yesterday at church the passage of Scripture, powerful. We've learned it a lot. We've heard it a lot. But today I'm going to explain it to you and break it down. It's Philippians chapter 4, 6 through 13. It's the Apostle Paul writing a letter to the Philippians. Now let me set the context real quickly. The entire New Testament, most of it, is Paul writing letters to churches that he had already started. If he went to Ephesus, if he went to Galatia, if he went to Thessalonica, if he went to Rome, he would write a letter back, and that's the letter to the Romans or the book of Romans. He would write a letter to the church of Ephesus. That's the book of Ephesians. He would write a letter to the church in Galatia. That's the book of Galatians. See how it works? Well, this is a letter to the church in Philippi. Now, here's what you need to know about the church of Philippi, which is going to bring some context to what we're going to read today. The church of Philippi had sent Paul an offering 10 years ago when he was in Thessalonica. So Paul's a traveling evangelist, and so people from time to time would take care of him. If he didn't have enough money, he had the trade of a tent maker. So he would make tents and he would sell them, but there are some times where he wasn't in a position to make tents. So the church of Philippi, 10 years ago, sent him a love offering or gift to help him to live, to buy clothes, and to eat. Now he's back 10 years later, and they've sent him another offering. So we're going to pick it up, and we're going to see him talk to this church who has helped him spread the gospel. Some powerful things about your state of mind. Now here's what you're going to see. 10 times in this passage of Scripture, he talks about how you and I think. So how you and I think is critical to you and I being content. What is content? Raising a barrier so that something is enough. Let's read the Scripture today. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. It says, don't worry about anything, but we could go home on that. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all that he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your heart and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. We're going to talk about that. Verse 8, and now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, what is honorable, what is right, what is pure, what is lovely, what is admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. So you saw me doing these things. You saw me being content. Now watch the list that he's getting ready to give us that the people were able to watch him do. Then the God of peace will be with you. How I praise the Lord that you are concerned about me again. Why? They sent him another offering to help. I know you have always been concerned for me, but you didn't have the chance to help me. Not that I was ever in need. Now, this is critical. Not that I was ever in need. He tells them, I appreciate what you gave me. Not that I was in need, though. Now, listen how he describes the past 10 years of what has happened. For I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of being content, whether it is with a full stomach or an empty stomach, whether it is with plenty or it is with little. What is the secret? Verse 13, for I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Even so, you have done well to share with me in my present difficulty. Woo-wee. Now let's break this down. Paul's talking about he's in a present difficulty, but how does he get to the point to say, thank you for what you've given me, but check it, I was not in need. Paul has learned how to have things and how to not have things. Boy, if we can learn that, that'd be powerful. Now, let's hone in on Philippians 4:12. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of being content. Whether it is with a full stomach, I'm full, or it's with an empty stomach. Whether it is with plenty or whether it is with little. What's the secret? I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Now, let me show you. This is so, so powerful. We have to look at this. Sometimes you and I have everything. There's a time when you are just blessed. Job is going good. Just got a promotion. Whatever it is. You just got a scholarship if you're a young adult. And you have everything that you need. You're not praying for things because in this season you're okay. But how many of you know you and I also have the seasons where we have almost nothing? You can go to work after 30 years and be laid off from your job. You can lose something. People can break in and steal something. So here's life. Almost everything, almost nothing. Almost everything, almost nothing. Now watch. Paul has been shipwrecked. He's been in the ocean a day and a night. Now imagine you are in the will of God. And here's where Christians get twisted. Paul was in the will of God. He was on a boat going on his way to preach to Caesar. And then all of a sudden the boat breaks up. God speaks to him, says, hey, everybody's going to live. But the boat shatters. He's floating in the ocean on a board, and his stomach is empty. Can you imagine just there, day in, day out, floating all day, all night? Sharks could be around. He's nervous. He's scared. Everybody's around, and he's hungry. But guess what he learned? He said, I've learned to say stuff like this, and here's where you and I got to get to. I might be hungry, but I'm glad I'm alive. And see, we don't know how to do that a lot of times in America. We don't know how to be content. Paul learned, yeah, I'm hungry. He wasn't denying the fact that he's hungry, but he said, you know what? I'm alive to be hungry. How many of us are focused on what we don't have and miss the opportunity that God has provided for us? Listen, sometimes you're going to have a full stomach. Paul taught in the book of Ephesians. He taught in Ephesus for 3 years. He did a Bible study. He was there for 3 whole years. Guess what? He probably didn't miss a meal. His stomach was full. And here's what Paul learned, and here's what you and I got to learn. God is God when you have everything, and he's also the same God when you and I have nothing. Oh, my goodness. And Paul said, I have learned the secret. Now, let me show you what he said. We have quoted this scripture forever. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Well, the key is you have to know what the word strength means. And here's what the word strength means. It means to put power in. So Paul is saying, I can do everything when Jesus Christ puts power in me. You and I are going to have a hard time accepting these two things if Christ has not put power in us. Because our mind wants to focus on what we don't have. Now check it out. He said, I can do everything through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ when he puts power in. Power in me to do what? Be flexible so that when I have everything, when I have nothing, I'm okay and I go back and forth and I can trust God when I don't, when I'm in certain situations. Listen, God is not God when you have everything and then somehow he's missing when you have nothing. And that's big. So here's what he learned. Here's what I want to show you today as we begin to close. He said, I can do everything. Here's what he meant. I can focus on Jesus because Jesus is my source. Now watch this very carefully, and next week we're going to get deeper into this. Jesus Christ is the source of Christians. Having stuff and not having stuff is your resource. God provides resources. You can work and have things naturally. So you have to raise up the standards sometime and say, I'm content with what I have. But when things go wrong, when you don't have certain things, you and I have to focus on Jesus and say, guess what? My resources might be changing. My resources might come and they might go. But guess what? Who never comes and goes? He said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. He said, I've learned the key to contentment. The key is to focus on Jesus, my source, and not trip out when the resources change. Ooh, that's some fire today. Listen, you and I have to learn to be content. Last point. The key to contentment is not what you have, but it's who you know. You know what? If what you have was enough, every movie star, every rapper, every singer, they'd all be at peace. Guess what? Most of them have drug addictions. Most of them are struggling. Most of them can't stay married. They have everything the average person wants, but they don't have Christ. They don't have peace. They don't have contentment. They can say what they want to say, but here's what I know. Every time I see them on TV, somebody's in trouble, somebody's getting arrested, somebody's drunk, somebody's having an issue. They have everything the average person wants, but guess what? They all need the same thing we need. They need to be forgiven like we do, and they need the strength of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. We are learning in this series, it's powerful, to be content. Listen, I hope you learned something today. What is contentment? Raising the barrier so that what you have is enough. Listen, if you're married today, your spouse is enough. You don't need to be looking and talking and walking and looking at somebody else, thinking about what you want to do and what you want to do and how you're going to do it. You need to raise the barrier, raise the standard and say what I have, what God has provided for me is enough. Now, I'm not saying don't work hard and don't acquire things, but guess what? You can have whatever you have the ability to earn and work for. Anything outside of that is a craving, and cravings get you in trouble. That's why if you are craving Krispy Kreme donuts, you're going to be in trouble. Listen, I hope you learned something today. Now, I want to close by inviting you into the family of God. I want to tell you what I told the church yesterday. A man was saying a prayer. He said, Dear Lord, 20 years ago we had Johnny Cash, Bob Hope, and Steve Jobs, the creator of the iPod and iPad. He said, Now, Lord, it seems like we don't have no cash. Seems like we don't have no hope. And it seems like we don't have no jobs. Dear Lord, please don't let Kevin Bacon die. He likes bacon like me. Listen, that's funny, but guess what? Dying is not funny. Johnny Cash, Bob Hope, Steve Jobs all contributed to society in their own way. And they never thought back then that they would be dead and gone right now. I want you to think about it. What are you going to do? Where are you going to be 1 minute after you die? I want to tell you that all of us are born in sin. We are born with the ability to sin. And let me tell you what sin is. It's real simple. Missing the mark of God and not getting the prize. That's all sin is. But all of us have done it. We were born with the ability to sin. And by the age of 2, all of us had acquired that. And we've all done it. You and I can only go to heaven if we're forgiven. Good people don't go to heaven because there are no good people. There's no list to tell you how good you are and how much good you have to do to overcome evil. That's religion. I'm talking about relationship today. Listen, you and I, just like Bob Hope, Johnny Cash, and Steve Jobs, we're all going to die someday. And my question for you is, are you going to die forgiven? Or are you going to die independent, thinking you know everything? Because let me tell you something. We can debate all we want to. You can watch this video and be an atheist and say whatever. But your last breath is going to prove what's the truth, and it's going to prove what's a lie. If I'm wrong and there's nothing, then you straight. But God forbid, if I'm right and heaven is true and Jesus Christ is true, which I know and believe he is, then you're in big trouble if you don't believe. You can ask Jesus Christ now to come into your heart. You can ask him to forgive you of all your sins. And it's real simple. You say, Dear Jesus, I've sinned. I've missed the standard and mark of God. I need you to come into my heart. Save me and forgive me. Now teach me to live as part of your family. Today, I am born again. Listen, I hope you learned something today. Come in next week and we talk about sources and resources in this new series, The Power of Contentment. This is Pastor Mark from Abundant Living HD. I'm out.